Hi everyone, welcome to our 56th video session with Adam French. Before we get started, let's introduce what we do at Impaction and what the purpose of these video sessions are, and then we'll ask everyone to introduce themselves in two sentences or less. So Impaction's mission is to connect people to jobs in the social impact space. We host these video sessions just to hear from social entrepreneurs and leaders in the space and getting people to, you know, getting spurred towards action for their local communities. So I'm going to, you know, introduce myself. I'm Shivani. I'm the CEO based out in Chicago, Illinois, and I've been working in the nonprofit and the education space for the last 6 years. How about Zara? Do you want to introduce yourself?
Sure. Hi, everyone. My name is Zara. I'm from Toronto. By background, I'm an accountant. So I've done the corporate desk job. But a few years ago, I switched to small business and social enterprise. I just started a nonprofit organization called Social Venture Circuit to just bring better resources and connection around social enterprise to my own local area. Thank you.
Awesome. Thank you. Emmanuel, you want to go next?
Hi, everyone. My name is Emmanuel from Malawi. My background is in education. So I'm the founder and managing director of Became Academic Center, a secondary school, which gives access to children from low-income families. I've also just started a nonprofit called Africa Innovate. So I'm the executive director of Africa Innovate. So it is a nonprofit which is aiming at giving skills to school children and out of school kids for giving them employable skills.
Very awesome. Thank you for joining. Bella, do you want to go next?
Thank you.
Sure. Well, nice to meet everyone. My name is Maribel. Can you all hear me?
Okay. Yes.
I'm the founder of Love for Immigrants. I'm also an educator. And Love for Immigrants is a social space for immigrant support. It aims to connect immigrants to their communities as respected, loved, and heard individuals by sharing narrative through art and storytelling.
Yeah, it is. Thanks, Belle. Shalini, you want to go next?
Sorry, I was taking myself off mute. Sure. My name is Shalini David. I co-founded Crystalis, and we serve children who are victims of different injustices, such as being orphaned or very poor or exploited. And we have an orphanage and also a community program in Kasese, Uganda. And so children who don't have a home, we provide it through our orphanage. And then for the ones in the community, we help their families with basic needs, education for the children, microloans, and income generating projects. Just hoping that they'll become self-sufficient and be able to take care of the children themselves.
Nice. I think we're all working in similar spaces here in the call. Seems like it's education, nonprofit work, community development work. So it's going to be an interesting session for you, Adam, for sure. So let me start with introducing Adam, and then you can add anything to your introduction afterwards. So today we're going to be learning about turning your vision into impact through design from Adam French. Adam is the founder of Emote Design and has worked with dozens of social entrepreneurs to clarify their business models, messaging, branding, and marketing strategy over the last 4 to 5 years. He knows what it's like to have a large vision and the frustration of not knowing the next step. This presentation is to build, to teach impact-driven individuals how to map out a business model around their vision of social change, identify their riskiest assumptions, and create experiments that get them closer to product market fit. Adam, we're so excited to have you here today. And if you wanted to add anything to your introduction, go for it. Otherwise, just start with your presentation.
All right, thanks for the introduction. I think that was good enough. I don't want to talk about myself too much here. So let's get to it. Cool. So everybody see it? Well, the video's not in the way. All right, so this is how to map out your impact business model. how to map out business ideas. Shivani already kind of did the introduction there. So while we're going through this, keep in mind, if you are a nonprofit, if you are a social enterprise, you have a business model. It just, funding might come from different sources like grants and donors, but you still have a business model. Super important to keep in mind. So the tools I'm going to be using are the Impact Business Model Canvas. So the Impact Business Model Canvas is just my riff on the normal business model canvas. I added a few sections and I'll be explaining all of the sections while we get into it. You can download this tool at this link right here. Shivani, do you want to share that? Should I put it in the chat? How do we want to distribute this?
Yeah, I can go into your presentation. I can just add it directly to the chat.
Perfect. Okay.
Thank you.
So that's the link you can download the canvas on to use on your own time. And then the other tool I'm going to be using is mural.co. Really, really amazing tool. If they had a referral link, I would use it, but I'm not using a referral link. I just love the tool. It's a great way to visually collaborate. So highly recommend using that if you work with a team or you are a visual thinker and you like mapping out ideas in general. So just a little context on when to actually map out your business model is when you're clarifying a new business idea. If you're starting a new business and you want to kind of get all of the stuff out onto, like, it's basically like a shorter version of a business plan. So normally when you start a new business, you write a business plan. But this is a much shorter and more flexible way of writing that business plan. A lot of times people spend 2 months on the business plan before even making a prototype. And that's problematic to me because the business plan is built on assumptions. So when you're starting out a new idea, your job is to validate all of your assumptions that hold the idea up, right? So that's one way that it's useful. Another place that it's useful is to educate your team on your business model as a whole. If you want your team to see how their different roles fits into the different parts of the business model, this is a really good way to do it. Say, hey, this team member, you own the customer segments, relationships, and, you know, channels part. And then they'll be able to see like what they actually do to drive value in the business. Another good time to map out your business model is when you're doing strategic review or looking to pivot. If you're like, okay, something's not working, we need to make some changes. It's a great idea to map it out, see what's not working with cash flow or with the value and customers. It gives you an opportunity to see the different parts of your business model, how they operate and what parts might not be working for you, and what parts you might want to change during a pivot. And then to just generate creative business ideas to solve a problem. So if you want to solve the problem of, let's, you know, you have some great problems you want to solve, let's say like acceptance and appreciation of immigrants, right? That's a very valid, noble problem to solve. So this is like, okay, how might we solve this problem? And then you can use the business model canvas as a way to reflect on opportunities or ways you could create a business around solving that problem, and who would buy, who would donate, who would benefit, and how you would make that value happen. So that's just some context. Now we're going to kind of dive into the process of mapping out the business model, pulling out assumptions, and creating experiments. So I wanted to give you all a choice on kind of what company to use. So you all have some awesome companies, and it sounds like some of you just started. So if you want to use your company, feel free to shout it out. We can start there. Anybody?
You could use Left for Immigrants if nobody else wants to volunteer theirs, but if someone is newer, shout out your company. We're not totally new.
Okay. Well, it looks like Love for Immigrants is going to be it. This is going to be interesting. This is going to be fun. All right, so let's map. Let's do it. So basically it starts, and this is getting a little bit into details of how I do this, which might not be necessary for you. But it starts with a template. I have this template here. Happy to share the template with all of you afterwards. The links in the presentation with the under the Let's Map button. So I think anyone can get to it. So basically, you start off by creating a mural from the template. And then this, it's kind of a lot. So I'll kind of walk you through each piece. So first, we do love for immigrants. And then we'll just get started with mapping. You can see there's some resources up here to help you during the process. If you end up using this template and you want information on how to use it, there are resources right there. All right, so let's go. Maribel, who are your customer? All right, so when mapping out, sorry, I'll give some context. When mapping out your business model canvas, you usually want to start with your customers and donors. A lot of people start with the beneficiaries. I think that's cool as well. Like, I want to help this group of people. So the beneficiaries would be immigrants. Is there any specific immigrants in the US? Is that kind of your,
okay. A lot of children of immigrants as well. I would say immigrant artists. Okay. There's also like educator, grant, there's a whole lot of different subgroups. And allies, immigrant allies.
Okay. So it's benefiting all of these people.
And youth, especially like activists, like youth interested in activism.
Okay. So already, right, we've mapped out who it's helping. And, you know, when you have your beneficiary segments, those are the type of groups that you put into the messaging. So Maribel, who is donating? Who is paying for this art? Who's kind of your customer or donor in this model?
So we're working under gift economy model at the moment, and we experimented with that. And so I would say people who gifted their time instead of like donations of money and gifted their artwork instead of donations of money are artists, allies, actually it's very similar, children of immigrants, and even like people who live abroad who are allies with the immigrant community in the US.
Okay. Who's paying, is anyone paying for anything in this business model?
No.
Interesting. Okay.
Not at the moment, but we are looking at experimenting with other ways. And immigrant artists are also donating their work. Well, I sometimes pay like very small amounts for things like website domaining, but not so much.
Okay. So your operating costs are very low, essentially.
At the moment. They're gonna increase. I'm gonna change the model.
Gotcha. So yeah. Okay, so let's do this mapping in the context of, and this might help you out a little, let's do this mapping in the context of if you had a value stream, of a stream of income in this business. Does that work for you?
That works for me.
Okay, so in the customer segment, that might be who would maybe buy the art, right? I guess, well, let's move to the value proposition. If you are offering something to buy or pay for, what might that be? What would you offer customers, or what would you offer the immigrants?
There's so many ways to go about this, but there could be one, like you were saying, where Love for Immigrants serves as a gallery and we help artists work from the exhibit, and then they give us some like sort of commission, even if it's low. So then immigrant artists themselves would be a part of this, and people who are in the art scene who appreciate the arts and purchase art.
So you're thinking of
as well.
you're thinking of connecting galleries with the art created by the immigrants in your community?
I'm thinking what if Love for Immigrants served as that middle ground with immigrant artists and people interested in purchasing immigrant art.
Love for Immigrants is the gallery. That's what you're saying.
Yeah, I'm thinking that could be the future. That's one option. There's many ways to go about it. We can start with that one just to make things simple.
Okay. Yeah. Let's start with that one. And then Maribel, for your kind of context, right? If you have a lot of different ideas for how you could kind of create value or how you could create a business around your idea, you would want to go through the first part of this exercise a few different times, one time for each idea. So you would say every business model is built around a value proposition. Like a lot of business models have multiple value propositions. When you're just starting out, or when you're just starting to create a business, you want to make it as simple as you can. So you want to have each canvas built around one value proposition, clarify each value proposition individually, and then you can bring it together all under kind of one roof after you have separate clarity on each value proposition. So one thing that you could do in using this exercise is try each idea in the business model canvas, see what the key activities, resources, partners, relationships, channels, all of that would be. And then you kind of make a judgment call. You kind of make a call based on your current activities, current resources, current partners that you have set up, and what you think you could be good at. You could take that and say, okay, this looks like it matches our strength set best. It looks like it matches my passions best as a founder. Let's move forward with that. And then that's when you would kind of go through the rest of the exercise.
Okay. Yeah. Or even simply like Leopard Immigrants charging an entry fee for the exhibit could be like another way to generate revenue that ties into the gallery idea. So even though okay. they're two separate ideas, they kind of unite.
So yeah, now we're jumping into revenue streams, which is fine. A lot of times when, you know, there's kind of a predetermined way to go through this. Customer benefit, beneficiary, and value proposition, and then you kind of connect the value proposition to customers. But, you know, as Maribel just kind of said, right, things come up like, oh, here's the revenue stream. So commissions from selling immigrant art, right?
Yeah.
And then entry fees for the in-person gallery. So you're offering a curated selection, and then you're offering a gallery experience that supports immigrants. So supports, I would say that displays culture of immigrants, something like that. So those are kind of the value propositions, right? Your business is built around providing these value propositions. So for the donors, the immigrant artists are donating art, right? They're providing the art. People who appreciate art and support immigrants, they're the ones actually buying those two things, right? Since the immigrant artists and allies are actually providing the art, and then immigrant allies worldwide would probably be buying it too. But I would say immigrant artists are actually a key partner for you, because they are producing the art, which would be a key activity. Kind of jumping around because that's how it works sometimes. But let's go back to value proposition. So is everyone kind of clear around what customer, donor segments, beneficiary segments, and a value proposition is? Is that clear to everyone what those contain? And you can just shout out if not.
Yeah, so value proposition is what value are you offering? What benefit are you offering?
Yep. So in terms of benefits, opportunity to get awesome art and support immigrants, right? That's kind of your main
and
benefit.
Exposure for artists, I think, is like a huge main benefit that I'm starting to see now.
Right. So that's actually
the partners. They don't have exposure, so we got to get better at marketing. But anyway.
that might be an eco-social benefit, right? Exposure to immigrant artists, right? That's a social benefit. And that can definitely be a part of your value proposition. But it's important to kind of separate it at the beginning to kind of see where everything is. Okay, so how are you creating relationships? What kind of relationships do you have with people who appreciate art and support immigrants and immigrant allies? It sounds like it's a community type of relationship, right? Like many to many connection.
Yeah, I would say that we're still very new in that space, but so far it's a social media community.
Okay. That would be a channel. Social media is the channel, right? So community is the type of relationship you have with your customers. That's kind of where the relationships come in. What type of relationship do we need to have with our customers and our beneficiaries in order to provide this value? The channels is where are you actually creating those relationships? So social media would be the channel. Awesome. So any other kind of thoughts on the relationships? How are you, like, any other like mechanisms that you're using to create relationships? Because that also, like, anything?
Yeah, for the artist, collaborating with a key partner with Voices of the World podcast, so they get exposure beyond the exhibit. They choose to share their story for podcasts. So that's a key partner.
Nice. Okay. So that's a great way to create relationships. It's a podcast where people who are creating value or your partner is telling their story. And people who appreciate art and support immigrants would definitely enjoy that, right? So that might also be a value proposition as well.
Impaction has been a partner in the past. So I don't know where they will go, but they've definitely been supportive throughout everything.
Okay, so they could go in key partners, right? All right, so social media, what other channels are you finding new beneficiaries or customers or partners?
I would say, Impaction is one of them, but there's this site called Pecha Kucha, and they have like a global audience, and so there is one channel that I found helpful during the exhibit.
Okay. I don't know how to spell that. I'm sorry.
No worries. I don't really remember either. I think it's K-U.
P-E-C-H-A?
Yeah. P-U-C-H-A. K-U-C-H-A. Pecha.
I like that. Has a ring to it. Okay, so Pecha Kucha community.
I'm probably butchering it. I think it's Pecha or something like that.
Oh, wow.
I think it's Spanish. So
yeah, it's we can't really clarify that in this context. So, you know, it's there. Apologies to anyone who knows that if we butchered it. Okay, so that's another channel that you're kind of connecting. Is that mostly connecting with partners?
No, that's mostly connecting with community that might be interested in the exhibit, not really partner.
Oh, so this is where you find customers. Okay. Or hypothetical customers. So another thing you can do when mapping out your business models is you can color code these different elements so they match each other. So the Pecha, this community, I'm not going to butcher it anymore. This community is it's green, right? So you can match that with people who appreciate art and support immigrants, right? They kind of connect, right?
Right.
Community is a big connector of those three too. And these two are mostly for people who appreciate art and support immigrants. And I think Immigrant Allies Worldwide kind of fits under this, right? There are people who appreciate art and support immigrants. So we can actually just get rid of that and keep this as the main one to avoid confusion. All right.
Okay. Also our website is a platform, is a channel.
Nice. Okay. And
can I jump in here, Adam? I know that we've got three other innovators on the call as well. So do you guys have any questions, any thoughts, anything that this, you know, exercise relates to your individual nonprofits? We'd love to hear from one of you guys.
Sure, I'll throw in an idea. I was thinking about, like, from the perspective of the artists themselves and what they might be doing to improve their skills or like professional development. Is that something they already have? If so, maybe that could be a channel you could tap into, or if it's something they don't currently have, maybe something complimentary you could offer. Cutting out, I think my signal's not very good.
Yeah, that's a great idea. I think that more experienced artists, maybe we could do some kind of workshop together, and
Belle, I think you might be cutting
resources,
out.
Maybe.
Belle, I think you might be cutting out.
I'm just let other people talk.
You can add anything to the chat if that's easier, Belle.
I like that as another value proposition. That was great, Zara. So like workshops and career training for immigrant artists. And you could probably have a lot of these be free, but maybe you could also have, if you've made a certain amount of money or if you're at a certain level, then you would pay for it so you can support this business model. If you're able to support it, maybe it could be like a pay what you can. Right? Because that's a type of kind of way to structure revenue. So maybe I kind of color coded this, that adds the immigrant artist into your customer segment. So now they're a partner and a customer and a beneficiary, which is great. You're engaging them on a lot of different levels. And the value is workshops and career training for immigrant artists. And then I don't know why I said pay what you type. But the revenue stream would be pay what you can. And then the channel for that would probably be social media. It would probably be Impaction. These are kind of general use channels, it seems, for Maribel. Same with a website. Maybe they come up with another website or a blog or a publication that has a lot of the knowledge that artists can use for career training. Who knows, right? And then that relationship would be kind of like a guide relationship where Love for Immigrants is guiding these artists towards success. So they're kind of like, it's like high touch. It's a lot of human connection, which can be expensive. but that's where this other revenue stream comes in, right? People who appreciate art and support immigrants, usually those people have a lot of money. So I think the way, and while you're doing this, you also want to think about how you're structuring, what's our largest revenue stream? What customer segment does that come from? So if we continue to color code and match this up with, and the yellow ones, we can kind of think of general purpose here. We can kind of think of them as covering, covering all of the bases. So looks like these revenue streams will kind of subsidize the workshops and career training. Okay, cool. So does anybody? So let's zoom in. Let's zoom in a little bit to the eco-social benefits. Maribel, I'm sure you've thought a lot about this, right? How are you helping larger society? What aspects of your business model are most crucial for increasing these benefits? So let's start with how are you helping society? What kind of positive outcomes are you having both for the immigrants, but also for society as a whole.
Can you hear me now?
Kind of, like a four out of five, or three out of five, but keep talking and we'll see.
I would say mainly like adding to the more positive narrative.
Okay.
That's a big benefit. Like if we think of ourselves as part of the ecosystem.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so what's
which in turn helps as a whole, not just me, not just Left for Immigrants, but as a whole helps create a more accepting, welcoming, and safe.
Accepting, welcoming, and safe.
Belle, I think to add to that, especially with your last event, the artists ended up getting some of their paintings or their art sold through your event. I think Bethany, she ordered a print version of one of your artists' works. So exactly. So it's like you're offering additional sales, not only exposure but sales for up and coming artists.
Wonderful. I did not know that went through. Okay. Great.
Yeah.
That's great. Okay. And I would say like last year's event, I don't think this year's will be the same, but or this summer's event, what took a mental health perspective. So it's adding to trying to help increase people's mental health well-being.
I would say others.
And others through the arts, like discovering the healing, you know, potential of the arts.
Okay. So this would kind of connect with the art, right? This would be green because it's most created by the art selection and the gallery that displays the culture. The exposure is kind of general purpose, right? Well, I'd say the exposure is green because it fits with the selection and gallery. Flipping the narrative, I would say that's green as well. More accepting and safe, that one's green. And then income streams, that would be orange and green. So that, let's keep that yellow because that's kind of general. That works for workshops and it also works for curated selection in the gallery. So one thing when you're creating your eco-social benefits, that's really important is what metrics can we use to measure these? Because people love metrics. The government loves metrics when giving out grants. CSR programs love metrics when thinking about where to give their money. So what do these look like in terms of metrics? Is there a happiness scale? Is there mental health? Maybe like you could say depression and anxiety for this group of immigrant artists that is involved with our community is much lower than the normal immigrant. You know, think about what real hard numbers you can use to illustrate the eco-social benefits, because that helps a lot with convincing, you know, you don't have to convince people that it matters. You can show them numbers and people respect numbers. Some people don't need the numbers, but for the people that do need the numbers, which many times are the people with the money, and that's why they have the money, because they like numbers, and they like to see numbers go up and down. So that's something to really think about when you're mapping out your eco-social benefits. What can we use to measure that numerically, just as we would measure revenues numerically?
Yeah, I would just push back a little bit here. I'm a big advocate for qualitative research. I think it has tremendous value, which is not fully acknowledged in our current society, but I think what I've learned is that when you're newer and younger, you can definitely reach out to the community and capture some of those stories as a way to measure impact in a more like storytelling kind of way. And so we've been going we have surveys and things like that, but we've also been going more of the qualitative route. And the first one really being on feelings. if, you know, people see the stories and they are part of what we're doing, and if that makes them feel more hopeful and more inspired, that is part of what we're also pushing for, is, you know, making sure that, you know, people's representation and portrayal inspires something positive in others. And so I think those are just as valid. And I think down the line, even like for next year's survey, we can definitely include more numeric values in there, like a scale. That's a great idea. I think for the moment, those were really helpful to gauge where people were at emotionally, since, you know, the topic is very emotional and sensitive to people. And then even like knowing the problem still persists, of narratives continuing to misrepresent, to portray immigrants in racist ways, or to not represent them at all. And so especially through the media, those are important, I think, feedback we've gotten from the community that can still even just show donors, like, this problem still exists. It's not a numerical thing, but it's more, I mean, we have like, you know, we could break it down numerically, but even just showing, you know, the community feels this problem still exists, so we need to work on.
Yeah, so I wasn't saying that qualitative data isn't valuable. What I was kind of saying is that usually it's only qualitative data that's created and presented to people, and it's really useful for yourself as well as people who's receiving those stories to put numbers to highlight the main things that are the issue, right? The main thing, 25% of people have negative mindsets towards immigrants, while 99% of immigrants are productive human beings in society. Those number kind of illustrates the story of the imbalance, right? So it's this right. Number, emotions, and the numbers are there just to help people ground and give people context to the stories, so they know it's working on the larger scale, and it's not just this one person's story, right? Like, yes, it's a very powerful story, but this is happening around the country, and here are the numbers to support that. So it's I definitely agree. Don't just do numbers, please, for God's sake, don't just do numbers. I probably start as Maribel is doing, start with a story. And then start thinking, what are the most powerful aspects of this story that we can create numbers around? Because these numbers can also be goals that you can strive for as an organization. We want to help generate this much revenue for immigrant artists. We want to help flip that 25% of people who look at immigrants negatively and make it less than 10%, right? It gives you solid things to measure and strive for. So that's the other part with the numbers, but definitely when you're telling people about it, the story is the center. So thanks for bringing that up. I'm glad you pushed back there so we could illustrate that point.
And for numbers, we have like a survey respondents, 43% felt the narrative around immigration was misrepresented or lack representation, or was racist in some way.
Yep. And
so that would be, and like, you know, I think ABL has statistics that for the last 10 years, and 13 years by now, social media, anti-immigrant groups use social media to create a negative narrative. And so that's part of the issue. It's not something I've conducted, but it's ABL's research.
Immigrant positive media and social media. To say, high percent of immigrant positive media exposure. So that's a hard eco-social benefit, right? There's more media that shows the positive and true side of what immigrants are doing in this country, which is sharing their culture and being very positive, contributing members to society, deepening our understanding of humanity. So awesome. So that's kind of the right side of the business model. This is I like to call it the, like, a right brain. It's the right brain of your business. It's the more creative side. It's the more customer facing side, other than revenues. But this is more, where branding comes into play, where marketing comes into play. How do you, relationships with your customers, channels, how do you reach them? Who's benefiting from your benefits? Who are your customers? What's the value you're offering? This is all kind of outward facing stuff. So we're going to move to the left side, left brain, the logical part of the business model canvas. And we're going to look at key activities, resources, partners. This is how do we generate this value proposition? How do we create this value proposition? So does anyone have any questions? Let's see, Howard. Okay, we need to speed up. so let's go.
We can have another organization do like the left side for their idea.
It would be kind of hard because you have to see it in the context of the whole business. So let's just continue with this and kind of go a little bit faster so we can get to pulling out assumptions. And I guess we'll just have to touch on creating experiments. What are the key activities that you would have to do to deliver these value propositions? Let's start with a curated selection of immigrant created art and then a gallery experience that displays the culture of immigrants. What are the key activities you would need to do to make these happen?
I would say the yearly exhibit, for sure.
So what would you have to do to create that yearly exhibit?
Create a relationship with artists. And one key activity we're doing now is creating an artist advisory board to help elect and nominate artists.
Nice. So that's a partner. That's a partner that helps you do this key activity, right? What's any other key activity? We can just do a couple and kind of keep it simpler. So create relationships with talent immigrant artists. You do this with the advisory board as a key partner. What's another kind of main activity you would need to provide this curated selection of immigrant created art?
Definitely event planning.
Okay, and then maybe get people plan events and get people to them. Okay, and what are the resources that you need that you act on? What are the resources that your business kind of depends on to create this value?
For sure, people. We really depend on our community.
What type of people?
The same type of people, like immigrant children, allies, artists.
Two people. Okay. Any other key resources that might be needed? Maybe like an event planning process, or maybe network of partners to sponsor events, maybe just kind of coming up with stuff. Okay, cool. And so your key partners, one immigrant artist, they actually create those value propositions. They provide the, so I guess another would be art. Art is a key resource, right?
Absolutely, yeah.
That's what you're selling. so.
Platform. Cool. Like technology is really important for us because we have virtual things.
Platform. Okay. That plays into that key activity of curating art, right? The artist advisory board helps you create relationships with talented immigrant artists. And another thing you can do is kind of just draw arrows. I'm pressing C and then clicking and then dragging. To create these arrows, and you can kind of connect your key partners to what are they doing, and how do they contribute to our key resources?
Cool.
and Impaction probably helps you plan events and get people to them, if I'm not mistaken. That seems to be what they do. They might help with the network partners to sponsor events. So just kind of zoom out a little bit and give some context. Once you know your key activities, once you know your most important key resources, then you can focus on those and you actually know what to focus on. So it's like, what am I supposed to do? How am I supposed to prioritize? Once you know your key activities and key resources that are the most important for creating your value propositions, especially the most important for creating your most valuable value propositions, right? Like right now it's this art that is theoretically the most valuable thing in the business. So you want to focus on the key activities and key resources and growing your partner base that support those key activities and resources. So that, you know, prioritizing the resources, activities, and propositions can really help you in saying, okay, what do I focus on? And so let's kind of go through the cost structure and social costs real quick, and then we can get to assumptions and maybe experiments. We got 7 minutes.
No, Adam, we have 2 minutes left.
2 minutes?
Yeah.
All right. Well, I'm going to skip that then. So overview, cost structure is the stuff you have to pay for. So here it would be like paying artists for their art, something like that.
Look at the budget. Look at your budget, right?
Well, yeah, I mean, the cost structure, the budget kind of comes from the activities and resources you need to do and how you operate with your partners, right? So you want the budget to come out of what do we need to create this value proposition in the way that works? Right. And then eco-social costs is like, what are some potentially harmful social or environmental things that could come out of our business model? One thing that you're not going to do, Mariba, I know you're not going to do this, but one thing that could become a problem is having this become like an art farm where you extract art from immigrant artists and make a profit off of it, and then it doesn't go back to them, right? So like, you want to think of like, yeah, you could think about like, what's the worst case scenario? And how could we avoid that, or like waste from the art materials, or like, you know, just the things that might harm the environment or the social system.
Even just like trauma, like what is that, triggering trauma of the art concept, right? To intent.
Right. That's potential. Potential as well. So let's just put that there just for. So assumptions, we're not going to have time, sadly, to go through this. So I apologize, but essentially your assumptions are what needs to be true. You ask yourself what needs to be true for this business model to succeed. Just kind of ask yourself what needs to be true for this business model to succeed and grow. And for this, people want to buy art from immigrants. That's like the simplest assumption that we can pull out. So normally you're going to come up with a lot of assumptions, right? That's one. Another assumption is we can sell the art for enough of a margin and still compensate the artists fairly while keeping our business going. That's another more complicated assumption that would require a pretty complicated experiment, which is okay, because that's what, you know, startups are. It's complicated, it's messy, and embrace that, and it'll make the process a lot easier. So after, are we done?
I think we are. I'm sorry.
All right. Oh, good.
Adam,
good.
How can we, you know, if there are other people who want to walk through this type of impact business model canvassing with you, how can we, is this possible? Like, what are you, you know, what are some things that, you know, I know Maribel, we used her test case today. We have other nonprofit leaders on this call as well. You know, what would you suggest them to do? And would you be open to, you know, collaborating with them or meeting with them afterwards as well, to walk through this to, yeah.
Yeah. So I'll pause the share or stop. I'll just stop it. So Yes, happy to do this with people. I just released this kind of workshop as an offering. So normally it would be $300 to go through this. Right now in the pre-launch, it's 50. So I'll drop that link in the chat for you to go to the landing page, and you can just schedule a session right on the landing page. And then we can go through this with you, and we can actually go through the full scope of it, and hopefully get you just a bunch of steps closer to having clarity and knowing what to focus on. So that's how we can do it. Otherwise, I'm gonna share the template with you, because this is, so I'm gonna share the template that I use, and you can use that as inspiration to go through it on your own. If you don't wanna pay the $50 or don't like me, I wanna give you an opportunity to do it on your own. So there's the template link, landing page template. But yeah, that's it. So thanks everybody. I hope this was useful for you all. I hope this was super useful. Would love to hear any feedback or comments or questions if we have time. If not, then it is what it is.
Yeah, no, guys, I would love to hear from you. How was this for you? Would love to hear from Zara, Emmanuel, Maribel, Shalini, anyone.
That was great. I've been working a little bit with the business model canvas for myself, and this one had a different format for social enterprise, which was very relevant, and walking through it was helpful. So I'm going to go back and definitely fill in my own. Awesome. Thank you so much.
Awesome. Glad it was helpful.
Yeah, I think I did something similar to this some years ago as well. But it is good to kind of get wrapped up in everything, and you don't always evaluate this way. So it's a good reminder. Thank you.
Thank you.
Well, this was definitely helpful for me, and I appreciate everyone's patience with going through Stuff for Immigrants revenue story.
Awesome. Glad it was helpful. And I'll share with you kind of what we have completed. I'll share that in the chat. And then you can kind of finish it up. I think you have to create an account if you want to finish it up, but I'm pretty sure it's free. I'm 99% sure it's free, at least the free version.
Screenshot of it. I would like to go through the example as well.
Okay. Yeah, I'll put the link in the chat, and then I'll also, I think I can export it, but it's a lot more useful as the link. So just like bookmark that link. Does that work? Well, I'll export it.
I can. So usually I send over follow-up emails to everyone on the call. So I can send these links in that email.
Perfect. Yes. Send those links. And then again, you can always book a session with me if you want me to walk you through it, if you get stuck. Or if you just want to start and make it easy. Awesome. Thank you, everyone. It was a pleasure.
Thank you, guys. So I have a couple of announcements before we close up. In next week, we are going to be launching two events. One is the Social Innovation Competition. You'll get funding for your idea if you have a physical product. So those applications open up next week. Second thing is the International Community Project. We're doing an international book drive this year. So you can donate your books over a course of a month. Our goal is to reach 300 internationally, but I think we can get far more than that if people around the world are joining us in this cause. So we will have more details to you about that on our newsletter. So sign up on our newsletter. And if you are looking for jobs or creating jobs, please use our social impact job portal, which is right on our website. It's completely free to use, and we'll connect you to our community members that way too. Adam, it was an awesome, awesome session. Thank you guys so much for joining. It was very informational. I know I learned a lot as well. and we'll have the recording to you within a week. So look out for that in case you want to reference anything back. I'll be sure to send out the follow-up email with all of the links in the chat as well. And just share this widely and invite your friends and family to join. Thank you guys so much. This was awesome.
Awesome. Thanks for the opportunity, Shivani. Thank you. Thanks everyone for coming.
Thanks, guys.